Wildfire has always been a part of the Western U.S. It's been used for thousands of years by indigenous people to manage landscapes. Before we colonized the landscape, the indigenous communities used fire every year. If you just take a look at the beautiful baskets they wove, you can see they're all made of the same diameter reeds. And if you ask them how that was achieved, it's that every year they would set those fields on fire. And so they had new shoots that came up, and they'd use those new shoots that all started at the same time to make those baskets. Here in Eugene, many people go to Mount Pisgah and they hike through the oak savanna. The oak savanna is there because the landscape was managed with fire. For the past century or so, we had a very different approach to that in North America in terms of putting out fires and not necessarily putting fire on the landscape to help with vegetation management. That compounded with climate change and increasing heat and dryness of the fuels on the ground. What we've really seen in the past 20 years is a real change in the number of fires, the fire behavior, the intensity of fires.
It's going to be another sleepless night for a lot of people. The park fire that's raging out of control near Chico. You can
see an inferno in southeast Oregon destroyed nearly 200 homes and outbuildings overnight. The bootleg fire is the largest of dozens of wildfires now burning in the U.S.
As of this morning, there are 21 uncontained large fires burning across the state of Oregon.
We do have some lookout towers where personnel are located, but we can use technology. We can go to these mountaintop locations. We can put in communication infrastructure and mountaintop pan-tilt zoom cameras so that we can have eyes on the landscape 24/7 throughout the year.
You know, it's an amazing group of people who use our camera, from Life Flight Networks to American Red Cross to all the emergency response communities throughout the region. So they get credentialed access to cameras, which Nick's going to point out to you.
So a public user can click on this. They can see, again, the map of intelligence over here, but also a 360-degree panorama that gets generated every 2 minutes.
There's a whole ecosystem of tools out there now for managing our risk around wildfire. So from the top down, we could start with satellites. So there are satellites zipping around that are using thermal imaging to spot hot spots on the landscape. And they fly overhead maybe every 6 or 12 hours, but that just shows up as a dot on a map. At the next level down, you have aircraft that are flying overhead. It's very expensive, but gives you a very rich data set. But really, this is a reactionary measure. There's not a fleet of aircraft that are flying around 24/7, 365, just looking for fires. So then the next level down is what we do, which are the terrestrial-based camera platforms. So we're going out and we're installing cameras permanently at locations that have great view sheds that can see high fire risk areas, and they are constantly monitoring the landscape throughout the year, looking for new fire starts, monitoring those locations, and giving real-time information to fire professionals who can look at the imagery and make intelligent decisions to marshal resources, assign personnel, and react to fire on the landscape in a more intelligent way given the context that the cameras provide.
Good that we're not using a 19-foot mast. Okay. We're using a 10-foot mast.
That's still ridiculous.
The Oregon Hazards Lab is OHAZ. We're a group that uses science, technology, and community engagement to understand, detect, and mitigate hazards. All the science in the world and all the detection in the world doesn't save lives and save infrastructure if you can't get it and have it be impactful to the community that needs it.
In my 35-year career, starting out, you know, didn't have technology like this. The cameras, the computer systems behind the cameras helping us find these fires, it makes decision-making not necessarily easier, but just gives us more tools in the toolbox to help make those decisions. 2024 fire season in Oregon, especially, was very busy. We had a wet spring, which grew a lot of grass. Then that water shut off. 1st of June on, we were extremely dry and extremely hot. Record temps for days on end, which dries the fuel out very quickly. The Cow Valley fire and the Durkee fire, right away from the start, that we knew that that was in a very steep, inaccessible piece of ground. We knew that that fire was gonna be a difficult one. The cameras helped in those decisions of being able to see those and see where they're going and move resources around.
Which fire is the priority to send the resources to? Because one that may be way, way out in the wilderness may not be the priority if it's sitting right next to Oak Ridge. If you can do that with a camera, there's very little risk for me to look at that smoke from where I am, where every time we launch an aircraft, there's always a risk to the aviator and the aircraft. The same with a fire engine and a crew or a hand crew or smoke jumpers or repellers, there's always that risk. So if we don't have to respond, there's one less risk that is, you know, the exposure to somebody in the field. If there's a public access side of the viewing platform for the cameras, when they hear that there's an evacuation notice, they can understand what's going on. So that maybe there's less reluctance to follow those evacuation orders or requests. We're in an information era where everybody's tracking all kinds of things and seeing all kinds of things, and I think it helps.
So, there's a mast already up there. Andrew,
which side do you want to start on?
So let's start on this one. It's gonna be the easiest. Start with the wind.
it's a good direction.
The JSA is going to be in the center on the center console of the Herc.
Okay.
We want to build the best environmental ecosystem real-time monitoring platform in the world, and I think we're on our way to do that. We want to be able to do science and mitigation and work with the community. We divide that sort of into two areas. One is called resilience monitoring. We need to have a resilient society. We need to monitor for earthquakes, wildfires, landslides, floods, etc. The other is scientific observing, right? In the sense we want to collect new data that allows us to understand things. So OHAZ sits in this space where we're doing applied research that benefits society, and we're collecting fundamental data that the scientists use to advance our understanding.
One thing that we're keen on from a scientific point of view is we're essentially creating a long-term record of what the landscape looks like over years, decades, hopefully maybe centuries. And this, I think, will be really valuable in terms of judging climate change and its impacts going into the future.